talking about a little show today called Star Trek Lower Decks. Just you wait. Let's introduce our panelists while we get our placards out here. Woo, what an honor. Arguably the most exciting day in Star Trek history. You can argue me online about that. Arguably one of the most exciting days. Let's introduce our panelists, ladies and gentlemen, the celestial queen of everything Trek today, Heather Kadin.
Hi again.
Alex Kurtzman. Woo, my boss, you've heard of this guy, Mike McMahan. Woo. Get him out of here. It's called Rick and Morty, everybody. Maybe you've heard of it. Let me also introduce one of my cast members here. We're going to get the placards out in a second. Tawny Newsome, get out here. And there she is. And also fellow cast member, Jack Quaid. There he is! Woo. We are excited to show you this stuff. Heather!
Jerry!
Godmother of all things Trek today!
I've known you too long.
tell us about Lower Decks. How did this all happen?
Well, a lot of us are huge fans in our office of Rick and Morty. And
hold on, wait for applause!
Rick and Morty. Which I think I was introduced, both of us maybe were introduced to by our children, don't judge. And, yeah. And our colleague, Aaron Byers, who is here in the audience, he's amazing, he said, well, you have to meet the guy who runs Rick and Morty, Mike McMahan, because he is this massive Star Trek fan. And he's such a massive Star Trek fan that after TNG went off the air and he was so sad about it, he started tweeting fake log lines to a fake season 8 of TNG that didn't exist. And Simon & Schuster thought it was so amazing that they then said, hey, why don't you turn your tweets into a book? So actually, you can buy this book. So now I'm plugging the book, which was not my intention. I'm plugging Mike McMahan.
Plug his book.
So Mike McMahan came in and said, I don't know if you guys would ever be interested in doing the kind of Star Trek I want to do. I'm like a lifelong Star Trek fan, but I'm curious to do a show about what happens on the lower decks of a ship. And we were like, yes, we were blown away. So that's how this came about.
So what you're saying is this, it's sort of the Downton Abbey of Star Trek.
100%.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
Michael, tell us what is Lower Decks about?
Guys, I cannot believe I am here at all in Star Trek and in Hall H and getting to share this stuff.
There it is.
Out of control. And even though this is amazing, the true dream is getting to be a part of Trek and this thing that I love. So we only have a little bit of time, and I'm going to try to tell you as much about it as we can. So Lower Decks is a half-hour animated show. So it feels like it's about the same length as like a Simpsons episode. And it focuses on four ensigns who are serving on a not-important ship in Starfleet. And they have stories they're stories that I think feel very Starfleet. They're stories about working on a ship, who you're working with. There's social emotional stories mixed in with sci-fi stories, because every Star Trek is kind of about a family, and our show is also about a family. It's just not the same family you've seen before. There's a lot of familiar Star Trek in it, and it was really important to me that even though we're a comedy, the comedy does not come from punching down on Trek or making fun of tropes. It feels like every episode is a real Star Trek episode, but we're focusing on people in the ship who are funny and that you will love. So it's been an absolute joy to work on. It takes place in 2380, so it's right after Nemesis, Voyager's back. It's kind of I'm a TNG guy, I really wanted to do it like that. So we're gonna show you some stuff and we're gonna tell you about some characters right now. And we have placards.
Let's move to one of our cast members, Tawny.
Hello.
Everybody, this is Tawny. Get
Hi.
Ready to fall in love. Tell us about your character, Mariner.
Yeah, so I am Ensign Beckett Mariner, and she is
She's like what I think I am in my head all the time. Like, she's always like very irreverent and like a badass and doesn't ever follow the rules. Meanwhile, I'm like a speed limit driving, just total wimp. But she's very good at all things, you know, Starfleet. She just doesn't care. Like, she's been demoted a ton of times. She should be way further in the ranks than she is. She's just kind of like, you know, a weirdo rock and roll party queen who just wants to ride her skateboard and eat her piece of pizza in peace, man.
Jack, everybody say hi to Jack down there. He's got a
hi. Hello.
Jack, tell us about your character.
I play Ensign Brad Boimler, and he's, that expression says it all. He's basically the opposite of Mariner. He's very by the book. He really wants to be a captain. He's very book smart, but he's just constantly getting in his own way. He gets very in his head. I always say, like, if he would nail the written portion of the driving test, like, flying colors, but once it got to him actually being in the car, it would just be a complete and total disaster. So, yeah, and these two characters, they clash.
Yeah.
They're friends.
What do we call them? We call them, like, Pearl Clutchy.
Yes, we call Boimler's very Pearl
Clutchy. Boimler's always scandalized by something, like, real, you know, real nuts that Mariner's doing.
Real. With a skateboard and pizza.
Always the skateboard.
Yeah, in the booth, it's a lot of me physically clutching imaginary pearls.
It's weird that you wear them to our recording session.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's nuts. I can't do VO without a good set of pearls.
That's what my grandmother always said.
Yeah. I know.
Michael, tell us about some other Lower Decks characters. We got Tendi.
Yeah, so Boimler and Mariner are often given the same jobs and go about it in totally different ways. They're working with Ensign Tendi, played by Noelle Wells, who, it's her first day on the ship in the pilot, and so we're getting to explore this kind of like new niche of the Star Trek world through her eyes. And she was a huge Starfleet fan, and even all through the Academy before she even got on the ship. So being on the ship every day just blows her mind. And there's no job, even she's in medical and she works in the medical bay, and there's no gross alien illness that she's not just absolutely thrilled to be dealing with. She's kind of like, if I get to be on a Star Trek ship, and I'd be like, yeah, whatever, I'll deal with anything, just I wanna be here. Like, that's what Tendi's like. And she's also hilarious and just like a source of joy. And then we have Ensign Rutherford, who I think you'll see in a second, who is played by Eugene Cordero, who's brilliant and funny and the sweetest guy in the world. And he is our engineer. And like Geordi LaForge, he's like amazing at engineering stuff, but unlike Geordi LaForge, he does not solve the problems by the end of every episode. Because he's learning, you know? Sometimes science is about learning stuff while you go and making mistakes. He's got this cyborg implant on his head that he just got, and it's kind of like when you get a new phone and you're like, wait, they got rid of the button, do I swipe now? That's him, but with like how he thinks, because he's like an early he's like a TNG early adopter, which is like a hard place to be. So those four are the ones that are kind of like, that's our family. That's our Star Trek family that we're experiencing this world in, and we're really excited to get to share it with you guys.
Aww.
Boy, I'm so mad.
Get him. There we go. That's a group shot right there.
That's a great group shot.
Let me ask Alex and Heather, what inspired you to jump into the animated world?
You know, obviously the original animated series is a huge fan favorite. And as we look to expanding the world of Trek, and you see that animation is at this incredible renaissance right now. It's at a renaissance in terms of some of the best stories that are being told in the animation space. You know, between Spider-Verse and Rick and Morty, you've got such an incredible
Spider-Verse?
You've got such an incredible moment. And the thing that's so fun for us is that we get to experiment with different animation styles and different tones. And, you know, I think in some ways people have perceived that Trek is limited in what it can be. And our thesis is that it has to be what it has always been to everybody, but can it also be more? It can expand. So it has to be a show for the fans first and foremost, but we want to bring in so many other people, and part of that is getting them younger, because there really has never been an initiative to get to kids when they were younger. And Trek is an amazing thing that teaches you how to be a better person in the world, and that has incredible values, and that talks about the importance of diversity and the importance of caring about other people and all of these really, really, really essential things that people should be hearing about and knowing about early, early, early in their lives so that we can make the world a better place. So,
woo! Preach out! Yeah! Tell them!
So, you take that, and then you add Mike McMahan, and you got something really weird, which is great.
I know, I'm hearing this, and I'm like, ooh, the scripts we've been writing, I'm not sure how young the viewers can be. It's approaching Rick and Morty age range, if not Rick and Morty burping and swearing.
Well, in fairness, the idea when we first said we wanted to do animation was to really do something we are also doing, is the Nickelodeon Star Trek animation. And then in walked Mike McMahan with an idea, I think, that was totally unexpected. And again, even by all of your reaction to the idea, it was something we looked at each other and we said, we have to do this.
Yeah.
It's so great. So I think being able to bridge the gap between comedy and adult and Star Trek and animated has been a blast. And we think all of you will love them and love the show. And
animation helps you do, like, for me and TNG, I was there for the B stories. Like, I love, like, okay, you know, Riker's trapped on a planet with his transporter clone. Great, I love that. But Data and Geordi are writing a play and they're getting in a fight about it. That's what I mean. I love that stuff. And to write a show that's primarily the kind of social stories on the ship that also has sci-fi happening and a comedy at the same time, animation helps it bridge from the first frame that it's like, oh, this is what I love, but it's focusing and heightening a thing that I always kind of knew was there, but wasn't always the main thing in the show.
I mean, I think part of what Mike is saying, and I guess it's the answer to your question, is like each of these shows has to be a love letter to Star Trek in its own way, right? Each one has to be different and it has to be special. And you can just hear from the way Mike is talking about it. And we knew it the second he came in and pitched the show, which I think I've said before, but he came in and he was like, all right, so you guys probably don't want to do this, but I want to do a show about the people who bring the yellow cartridge to the replicator so the banana can come out the other side. And he was like, and then I said, stop, we have to get you an office. Right now.
It's always good to start a pitch by saying, all right, you guys are going to hate this.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it actually raises a good question. Who are you trying to reach with Lower Decks? Like, what?
I think anybody who loves Star Trek and wants to explore more of it and find new characters to love and see new, you know, standalone episodes with sci-fi heightened dramatic elements, but then also like characters that care about each other and learn and grow and change and investigate other things in this world that we love.
But also I think people who haven't had an entry point yet into Star Trek, if you're a fan of The Simpsons, you're a fan of Family Guy, you're a fan of Rick and Morty, you're just a fan of comedy in general, I think this should be your show and your way into Star Trek that hopefully then makes you interested to see more shows in the universe.
I know, it's funny because it's funny enough and it's clear enough that if you've never seen Star Trek before, this could be your first Star Trek and then be like, I guess there's some live action Star Trek too.
Right.
But if you love Star Trek, it's in a shared universe, so there are jokes in jokes that only you guys will get.
Right.
About like Odo's bucket, you know, like you don't
Odo's bucket.
Yeah, we got Odo's bucket. But like you don't need to know Odo and his bucket for you to believe the characters in the show know about it.
Right. Yeah, I love every now and then I'll come across, I mean, I'm a fan, but I'm not, you know, the most educated fan, obviously. So I'll read things and I'll be like, I think I remember this, but like we have to stop a recording session so Mike can be like, okay, so in this one episode in TNG season 5, and he like gives me the whole lowdown of it. I love those types of things.
I know, the show is a mix of people who are steadfast, have seen every episode of every series a million times, and then people who are coming into it new and we're all watching it together and it's that shared experience and like, making new fans while we're making it, it's awesome.
Let's talk about the bridge crew.
Yeah.
Come on, where it's all at, on the bridge.
Yeah, so it was important to me that our ship felt like it was a real operating ship in Starfleet, and that there were characters on the ship, senior officers, who consider it to be their show, even though it's not. I mean, they don't know that. So we have a fully fleshed out bridge crew that we can show you here. So we've got Lieutenant Shax, played by Fred Tatasciore on the side, a big, muscly Bajoran who wants to eject the warp core all the time. We've got Don Lewis as Captain Freeman in the middle there, just like a stoic, ethically bound, awesome, classic, you know, Starfleet captain. And then we've got Commander Jack Ransom over there, sort of a hunky guy.
Yes!
Played by this goofball.
Jerry O'Connell. He was about to say Jason Bateman. That happens all the time. But it's Jerry O'Connell.
And he's kind of like Riker if you gave Riker like a little bit of speed and a little less shame.
Take it!
It's like a California Riker. And then Gillian Vigman plays Dr. Tana, who is Acacian, where there's a lot of references to the original animated series, which I love as well. We reuse a lot of types of aliens that only existed in that show, plus across all of Star Trek. But Dr. Tana is our head of medical and is really, really bad at talking to people, but really good at solving sci-fi space mysteries. So,
and she has no tail.
She has no tail, and Heather is so bothered by that. She's like, where did it go?
But I love that the original Cation was this like sexy feline. This is an alley cat that just got into a fight.
Yeah, exactly. You know, we like taking things from the original animated series that feel like it's a reference, but then we're doing our own thing that feels right in this show. So no purring sexy Cation guys, not yet, I'm sorry. But you know, I don't know, maybe Dr. Tana has like a super inappropriate cousin. Yeah,
right.
Anything you want to talk about the recording sessions and how much fun they are? I mean, I can say for me, I don't think professionally I've had as much fun as being in a recording session with Michael McMahan.
You have a lot of fun.
I mean, and I just know that all of you are going to have as much fun watching it. I mean, is it as much fun for you guys when you're in there?
Yes, absolutely. It's insane.
I'm talking at the same time. It's so great.
It's so great. We love it.
We love it so much.
We love doing it together, too. Like, occasionally Jack and I will get to record together, which is just so ridiculous, because I don't think we say most of the words that you wrote on your fine script, so allow us to apologize for that,
that's
sir.
That's okay.
What we tend to do is just, like, riff and play off of each other and find things and... Who knows what you'll use, but the freedom to be able to do that is just, I mean, as an actor and an improviser, that's such an amazing gift to be, like, trusted with it. So it just makes it even more fun.
My favorite parts of our riffs are the last 10 seconds where we're like, there's no way this is getting in the show.
Yeah, where we should have stopped 15 seconds ago.
But someone was like, keep them going.
Yeah.
Let's see where this goes.
Michael, anything else you want to share with all the fans here in Hall?
Okay. In Hall? In Hall?
I'm up here! I can't believe it! I was right back there last year. Anything else you'd like to share with Hall?
So you guys all know that one of the most important characters on one of these shows is the ship. And we have a brand new ship design and class. It's called the California class of ships. And the ships, this is your preview of it. This is all we're showing you. What do you think, Jack and Tawny? Was that cool?
I think it's amazing.
I mean, that was the greatest drawing of black squares and yellow lines I've ever seen.
Look at this, baby. We got a holodeck on the ship. This holodeck breaks all the time. It never works right. No, we're not going to show you the design of the ship today, but I wanted to tell you that it's a California class. We have a whole class of ship that operates at the same time as the larger classes of ship, but that they do kind of like support work. So we're gonna be exploring that, and the show takes place on a ship named the Cerritos. And that's Lower Decks.
USS Cerritos, everybody. The USS Cerritos crew right here. We're doing the real work out there. Oh man, that is exciting. Alex, we hear you also have one more announcement to make with all of us in Hall.
Yes, so I've been listening to a lot of your podcasts, and they're great, and I think it's high time that we have an official Star Trek podcast. So we're going to have one starting this year, and this amazing woman to my left is going to be the host of our new Star Trek podcast.
I'm so thrilled. thank you. As a fan, I'm so excited to have, frankly, the access that you guys have to be able to, I mean, who out here hosts a podcast? Every one of you, right? You each have three? We all do. Some of the hardest stuff is booking and just, trying to get people who you think are interesting and cool, and I mean, the amazing wealth of cool people that you have that we'll be able to talk to just about general themes in Trek. You know, I think it's important to say it's not going to be, a recap show.
Yeah.
It's just going to be general themes, talking with people who are maybe loosely connected to the world, other fellow fans. I'm pumped.
I think the idea is that Trek has been this incredible cultural conversation for 53 years, and it's going strong. And yeah, we'll bring in people who are involved in the shows, and they'll talk about their experiences on the shows. But we also want to bring in people who haven't necessarily been on the shows, but who've been deeply influenced by Star Trek, and talk about its influence on science, and talk about its influence on, on everything in the world. And we're at an incredible moment right now where I think the cultural conversation that Trek has enabled for so long needs to be loud and strong and proud, and that's what this podcast is going to be.
Love it. Hey, listen, let's thank Michael, let's thank Heather, let's thank Alex, let's thank Tawny, let's thank Jack. Star Trek's Lower Decks coming to CBS All Access 2020. It is my honor to now introduce Dominic Patton, who's going to be coming up with a little show called